So if you want to be heard, you might, I mean, just.
Well, what's the point of taping it if you're not gonna be?
Well, yeah, so, no, I'm just saying, just be cognizant of the, of it when you're talking, because it's not that strong of a microphone.
Well, it sounds like when it's taped, you know, well, that's all that should do the difference for us.
Exactly. I agree. Okay, so, so anyway, all right. There are some handouts here, maybe we should make sure everybody's got them. Mission roles and responsi-, oh, did you hand them down there? There's a, this is the list of folks. Nia Stewart is, we don't, oh, there it is, it's on there. Hers is on there. So the one we're missing was Al's, and he wrote it on there, all of them, so, okay, so, yeah.
Nia Stewart's what information?
I just see that her email is there, YSKPGRL, I think it's hers. So, not her address, but, or not her number, but anyway, that email. Okay, so, everybody's got everything needed, okay, so. Welcome you all.
But I'm going to.
I wrote up a little bit. Okay, so I'll just go ahead and say it. Okay, so, yeah, so we're missing a couple people, hopefully they will arrive. But anyway, welcome and thanks for being part of this task force and assisting council in this important work of strengthening our justice system. And I took from the draft vision for local policing, which may be the actual vision, just to say that strengthening the justice system is talking about making safety the center of our justice system, that it is support-oriented, citizen-focused, and has a commitment to the well-being of all citizens and the community as a whole. And that vision statement was developed, I believe, by Mary Ann Brian Hausch and with the police department, and council weighed in as well, correct?
Yes, council approved.
Yeah, okay. You probably are already clear on this, but just to say that the work of the task force is to recommend, recommend policy to village council. We're not a police review board, although perhaps we will recommend one. You know, so we're focusing on policy. If citizens come and have a particular concern the way you would bring to a police review board, you know, it's possible that something, you know, in incidents that citizens have concern about, that policy, that we would make a recommendation about policy, but we wouldn't actually look into a particular complaint. That's not our role. We will be informing ourselves and the community about current practices of our police department and the mayor's court.
Hi, sorry guys.
We just got started, so take a seat. And so the first thing we're going to be doing is informing ourselves and the community about current practices of our police department, mayor's court, and potentially just basic tenets at the foundation of our criminal justice system. This could lead us to decide we want to do some kind of a forum, you know, public forum. You know, we want to be informed and we want our citizens to become more informed, so we want to help make that happen. But one thing council has said is that after the first section of our work is focusing on what is happening now, you know, and after we get done with that part of our work, council has asked for a report to be brought to the council. So, and that's one public forum, you know, for the whole community as well. The second part of what we're going to be doing is researching best practices, innovative approaches, and justice system reforms that address the kind of concerns that many of our citizens have, and really the national, or are now concerns of the national, on the national agenda. Institutional racism, disparate impact on people of low income, young people. We'll also be looking at drug control and addressing the needs of the mentally ill when they have contact with the justice system. We're going to be thinking about protecting the civil rights of all of our citizens. So I tried to just summarize most of that is in the resolution. So I'm the council-wise liaison. Mary Ann is the person, if I'm not here, that will step in for me, and she may attend or not attend our meeting, all of our meetings. I wanted to talk a little bit about sort of how we function as a committee and kind of give people's input on that. The first issue, so I'll just go over all of those, and then I thought we could talk about each one individually, so the committee can attack it. We call this a committee probably, that people can weigh in on it. First thing is leadership, the chairs, potentially the leadership committee. Another thing is the rules of our meetings to make sure that everyone is able to participate and that we can have effective meetings. The third one is a question of decision making. Do we want to use Robert rules? How do we want to do that? And then how are we formalizing communication with the chief of police, Patty Bates, our village manager, and Mayor Fogart? And then finally, how do we want to welcome citizen input? Mary Ann and I are recommending, I think I can speak for Mary Ann, that we not immediately decide as a committee who's going to take leadership, because people don't know each other. And so we thought the next two or three meetings this time I'm going to chair. I had met with Mary Ann and Ellis. And Pat, who's done leadership, has had a lot of experience leading groups on work plans, developing work plans. There's a fair amount of work that we are being asked to do. So figuring out a way to plot that out on a time frame is, she's got a lot of experience. So anyway, we decided to meet with Ellis and Pat just to think about these first couple of meetings. So we're kind of the leadership committee at the moment. But I was thinking in two or three meetings that the committee should then weigh in on who they would like to see as their chairs, or right now it's kind of three or four person committee.
And secretary. We need someone to take
notes. And we need somebody to take notes.
We have public records.
That's true. Well, we are being taped, and that is a public record, so that helps us.
Question, Julie.
Yeah.
Are we going to have an opportunity to find out who we are and why we're on?
Yes, that's next on me. I think maybe, well, I don't know which we should do first. Maybe we want to do that first, but I was.
I was just curious.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah.
I think you're on a roll. I keep going.
What is it?
You're on a roll. Keep going.
Maybe. Don't interrupt me. So anyway, we were going to suggest that we would take the lead the next couple of meetings, and then we would, then the task force can decide for itself. Let's see. So I guess that's kind of where we're at. I mean, so do people want to talk about that a minute? I mean, what do you think in terms of, does that make sense, the idea of? And then if there are people who want to put their names forward, you know, like the chair of meetings, the three things, I mean, I think we're at the beginning of each meeting going to be doing reviewing agendas, and at the end of the meeting, setting tentative agendas as a group. But I'm imagining if there's co-chairs or if there's three people, that they're also going to be thinking organizationally also, so that I'm just kind of taking responsibility for that. So those two jobs, the chairing, the sort of keeping things on track, and then the third thing, basically at this time, the chief, the mayor, and Patty are not going to come to our meetings. We talked to Patty about it and came to the conclusion that for the committee to really get on its own feet and to have a, to sort of, you know, become cohesive as a group, that it would work a little better without having Chief coming to every meeting and, you know, Patty coming to every meeting. You know, we just thought the committee might be looking to them for answers a lot, and somehow it could interfere with us kind of becoming cohesive as a group. And so those would be the jobs of those people. So does that, how does that all sound to you? Do you have any questions or thoughts on it? Have any disagreement about that kind of plan?
Seems like it, at times it would be helpful to get some input from the chief. And
I'm sure we're going to be asking them to come to meetings. Yes, absolutely. Yeah, it's more a question of you know,
just starting out.
At least getting started, and then we'll kind of.
You're not saying they would never.
Yes, absolutely. And until they are here, we wanted to kind of formalize a communication system so that there wasn't some, so they weren't feeling out there wondering, well, we're going to have the tape so they can watch it, but so they can have some direct communication, so we can make sure those communication system is strong. So they're not feeling disconnected, or so citizens aren't thinking they're disinterested, for example, you know, because they are interested. So, and then in terms of the rules by how we, I mean, I don't know, I don't know that this group is going to have any problems really talking to each other and listening to each other and that sort of thing. But in, so, if they're, I mean, I guess I just, you know, sometimes you get into committees where they're not, they're functioning in such a way that either some people are really dominating, some people aren't feeling, maybe they have space for their comments and thoughts. I'm kind of feeling like if we run into a problem, maybe we can just address it there.
Yeah, this is a group of people, I don't think that's an issue terribly much.
Yeah.
I agree. But if it is, you know, respond.
Well, I understand. I guess I don't think doing the setting up communication rules today makes sense, but maybe the next meeting, because if we have citizens, we want to know that. I am in favor of talking about how we communicate with each other within the group and outside of group, and it's not that easy.
So
we'll
get that on the agenda. One thing the council does is if we're discussing a particular item on the agenda, a lot of times what we do, and I don't know if we want to do this, is we talk about it first, because sometimes citizens are raising their hands at different points, and it's sort of like, so we usually talk about it first and then we open it up for citizens. Not a lot of citizens here tonight, but you know, potentially there could be particular items or little meetings there could be, so that tends to work a little better, I find, than to constantly be stopping.
Might actually answer a lot of the questions ahead of time by doing that.
Yes. And then there might be issues that we're taking votes on, if we do, are people okay with motions and seconds?
No, I agree with Marianne. I think we should postpone setting up our guidelines about how we'll make decisions
okay.
and how we interact, and probably not just jump into that right now.
Okay. Okay. Sounds good. All righty. One thing I should say is Judy Kittner's coming to talk to us about sunshine and conflict of interest. When she shows up, she would appreciate if we'd stop doing it because she needs to get home to her children, and so she'd like to get them over and do that. So at some point she will show up and we'll just stop going over and doing it and listen to her. So we are to the point of introduction. So yeah, why don't we go around and hear from people why they were interested and what they hope to see happen and that sort of thing.
Do you want to start?
You want to start? Sure.
Okay. Kate Hamilton, and I'm on the Human Relations Commission. You can say more than that.
Send me a bad example.
This is a chance for us.
This group has never met together.
Okay.
As a group. And so this is a chance for us to start to get to know each other individually and as a group.
Okay. So I've been on the Human Relations Commission for a couple of years. And at the beginning, close to when I first started, we organized some communication between villagers and the police department, the chief. And I was on the committee to help find the village manager. I grew up here and I am used to a different type of police force. I'm used to what I had and what we all had. And I think that Yellow Springs is usually at the forefront of a lot of these things. So I think that we can make some good changes. I'm interested in doing that.
Did you graduate from Yellow Springs High School?
Yeah.
What did you do?
90. Yeah. Well, my last name, my maiden name was Monahan.
Oh.
I don't know if that's a good O. Sometimes I try not to, you know, admit to it. So, So I don't know. My husband is just retired from the military after 21 years, and we've lived all over the country in the last 10 or so years. And we were lucky enough to get stationed back here. And I have 3 kids, and I wanted them to have a similar experience that I did growing up. So it's important to me that, you know, our village is happy and healthy and that people care.
You've done some work with the police department, haven't you?
I met with the chief about carrying the antidote for when you overdose Narcan, and he was really good about doing that and looking into it. It wasn't as easy as I had thought it was going to be originally, so he really did listen to us and decided to get it, so all the police officers carry it. So I did that with him. I can't remember what else I go and talk to him about different things, and we have a pretty good relationship. Probably doesn't like me, but he probably goes, oh, she's calling again. But I think we have a pretty good relationship.
Yeah. Any particular concerns?
Lots of concerns. Lots of concerns that were addressed. With some issues that have happened with the police locally and nationally. So I don't think we're immune to what's happening in the rest of the country. And I don't think we're immune to what's happening in the rest of the country. And I also think that it would be good if we made a more streamlined approach to hiring, in that we did sort of a Yellow Springs 101. I also think it would be a good idea to have a full-time social worker. I put that in whenever I can. A full-time or a part-time social worker that works with the police department and the village and connects all the dots. So when you see the newspaper and someone couldn't find their glasses the next day, the social worker can connect that person with everything, rather than it just, you know, always falling on the police department. And it would cost the same as a police officer. I think that's it. Was that long enough?
And you have kids at Mills Lawn, or?
I do. I have a 12-year-old, a 9-year-old, a 7-year-old.
Zoe?
Yep.
Oh.
Zoe, Justin, and Alex, they're infamous. Zoe and Justin are on the Bulldog News. Alex is running wild. They keep me very, very busy. NHRC keeps me busy. And then I do some other things with Aaron Sari. And I can't remember what else I do. I'm sure there's another thing. Am I forgetting another commission?
No commission.
Or something? I don't know. I'm scattered tonight. I had to be in three. Oh, yes. And I'm in the Women's Empowerment Group with Gudgel and a bunch of other people at the school. And we do a lot of work there.
Is that at the high school? It's
at the grade school, but we work on some stuff at the high school too. We're thinking about merging with Simply Women and becoming one group versus two.
Is this working with students?
No, we work with each other. We plan things like self-defense classes and girls' night out. We talk a lot about different programs we want to do and consent and those kind of things. It's mostly around the girls. And then we try to, you know, put some pressure on to avoid some things like consent and things like that. So, yeah. That's all I do, right, Steve? Do I do anything else?
I'm sure you do.
I'm sure I do, but I can't remember.
And your co-chair of...
Yeah, I'm the co-chair of the HRC. I forgot that part too. I had to be in three places at once tonight, so...
Who's the other co-chair?
I'm actually vice, I think we said it's more vice chair. Nick Cunningham is the chair, and I'm the vice chair. Yeah. Yes, good, yeah.
So I'm John Hempling. Back in 2009, I worked with a friend of mine, Johnny No, on a documentary about the relationship between the youth and the police. And after we made that video, we were considering making another video, so I started doing research into the history of, like, okay, let me back up. So the reason that we made the documentary about the relationship between the youth and the police in Yellow Springs was because people my age and people younger than me that were still in high school really felt like the police harassment was really wrapping up in 2008-2009 of the youth. And so after I made that video, did some research on sort of like the history of basically what the department was doing before and like how it had shifted up to 2009, or 2008. And basically it goes back to Tim Lopez being killed in 2002, his body being found in 2004, and the Yellow Springs Police Department becoming a member of the ACE Task Force in 2005. And we did some records requests of basically the police department's misdemeanor citations, and those were going up like consistently from like almost from very few in 2000, like up to 2008, it was continuing to increase. I guess my other relevant experience was petitioning the village to basically support us in putting a bench downtown, and I got a lot of young people to sign that petition, and I would always ask them to please, like, this is the date that I'm going to present the petition, like, please show them to the meeting, and they were like, like, maybe, but, like, there's basically, like, no way that the council's going to support you, like, they don't, like, care about young people, and so, like, I presented at the meeting. Like, literally, like, I got, like, over 100 signatures. Literally, no one other than me showed up. And council supported the petition. So, like, just to, like, I guess that just, like, underlines that when you're, you know, a member of, like, less privileged groups, like, there's a lot, like, your experience with institutions of power are that they don't support you, so you don't participate.
Are you from the village?
Yes, I have lived in the village since first grade.
Okay. And did you come out of Yellow Springs High School?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, 2008, I would have graduated.
There was also the whole drug dogs thing at the high school, which
I did help organize Yellow Springs Youth Council. This is basically at like in the same time period. This is concurrently with everything else. They were bringing drug dogs into the high school to just do a random sweep, and then if the drug dogs like hit, then they were gonna like search that spot. And I think they did end up finding weed, but like on like a substitute teacher and on like a contractor. But anyway, we held some forums and basically people were just like, we don't, like, we would tell them our experiences with the police and our feelings about this initiative. And basically, the adults just like didn't believe us, but the video seemed more like persuasive than the actual in-person meetings.
Well, just also you went to the school board about the drug dogs. And I think there was a fair amount of support there at the school board. You know, listen, remember didn't you get a petition? Several youth did come to that meeting.
Yeah, the
organized effort.
Yeah, basically a lawyer told the school board, like, you have it's actually your responsibility based on like your own, like they passed a I guess this issue had actually come up like however many years earlier. I didn't know about this. And the school board at the time had decided against bringing drug dogs in and had structured it so that basically drug dogs could only be brought in if the school board approved it. And then the school board, you know, when I was involved, probably wasn't aware of that history, but they were informed that it was their responsibility at a public meeting. They were informed that it was their responsibility to decide whether or not to bring drug dogs in. But instead, drug dogs were brought in without the school board doing anything. Apparently, the school board was fine with that. So I don't know. It's just like that's why I didn't tell it, because it's just like a boring process story.
Is your video in the library?
The video is on YouTube, and anyone who wants to see it, I can send you the link.
What is it called?
Public Prohibited.
So if we Google that in your name, we can find it?
Maybe. I don't know. It hasn't been seen that often, so I really
don't
think
so. But it's public on YouTube.
It is public on YouTube, and I can send you the link. For sure. I could just... Should I just send it? I could just send it for you.
Yeah,
I'll
send it to you.
Okay.
Yeah,
is that all right with sunshine laws?
He just can't reply all.
Okay.
Yeah, he just can't, yeah.
Yes, hello. Stephen McQueen. Does anyone have a mint or gum or something along those lines?
I have a peppermint. I have a really strong peppermint.
That'll be fine. Just a little.
Should we give those to you before you start talking?
Yeah, no, especially because I need to start talking. however,
it's a bead. Don't put all of them, just take one.
Yeah.
Anybody can have one.
I need to roll up a $10
Exactly.
One, and then you bite it.
Then you bite it. Okay.
If you want to bite it. If you want to freshen your breath, you want to bite it. If your stomach hurts, you can just swallow it.
No, it's more of the getting cut in the
throat. I feel like it is.
Oh, yeah. So you want gum? Because gum is good.
I thought you were saying breath was fine.
No. What's the breath there?
I thought you were saying the gum.
Unless you're saying it's a breath.
I don't know. I'm drinking coffee.
That's a little weird, but I should get your stuff.
No, it was good. Anyway, so, my real name is Steve McQueen. I'm sure that sounds familiar to a lot of folks.
Okay.
Named after my father, and it was, and I did, you know, long story short. I am originally from New Jersey, and I went to Antioch from the years of both. I transferred to Antioch and was there from 03 to 05. And then I moved here to Seattle Springs, and I've mainly been here. I have traveled a lot, and I do go home often. Well, I used to go home very often. Excuse me. Recently, getting engaged to a woman I've been with for almost 4 years now, and so, I've been able to kind of settle down and get involved with a lot more, mainly for the kids' sake and how much they've become a part of my life. And so it started with HRC. I'm also a member. I'm secretary of HRC. It's been a full year. It'll be 2 years actually in November. It'll be 2 years in November. I'm also a member of Community Voices from 2015.
What is that?
Community Voices. Community Voices is a class given at WYSO. Basically, it's all about giving people journalistic skills to go out and interview and get the word out. It's almost StoryCorps, but with the much with actual skills given versus just here and tell your story. It's almost like what you can go and interview others. You create stories, which is something that's not really done. So that would be a huge difference. That led to numerous other things in which now I am a board member for Home Inc. And also now a board member for YS Heritage. So I'll be giving tours pretty soon, so if you see a bunch of people following me, that'll be why.
And that's the new, that's like historic walks in Yellow Springs?
Correct. I got involved because we're doing a Black, you know, 365 got connected with YS Heritage to do a Black Yellow Springs historical tour. But they needed some new board members, and this will help us connect even more. And so, but they asked if I like doing tours, which is actually why I wanted, because I do love giving tours. Kevin's all research, I'm all presentation. So that's how we work together on that.
You're part of 365 Project, right?
365 Project, Young People of Color, or YS. YS Young People of Color. Yeah, there's a Antioch Work Project. I kind of stay with it around here often. And it's run for Central Chapel. Yes, yeah, see, well, I think we know more about each other than we
about ourselves.
Yeah, right. Yeah, if you could write one. But when I got involved with this, it's basically, I was able to see the kind of tail end of people growing up here and everybody knowing them and their kids. And so Officer Green, I was able to build a very good relationship with as a student of Antioch, and then moving here. And I watched him perform, I've watched, you know, been to the house, and really good friends with his wife and child. And being from New Jersey, there was no such concept of that. So it was really cool. Miller, I believe, still lived here, and he was also an officer. Didn't get to build a rapport anyway, but there were people that knew the officer still. Nipper's another one, yeah. But the concept that people knew the officers of growing up with them, I thought it was a very fascinating concept to me. And I saw the difference it made. I saw the difference in the comfortability on both sides. Both sides knew who was being dealt with. The fact that that's changed, things change. I'm absolutely willing to move forward. And so still liking what I saw and what can we do to make it more like that, with the fact that that's not going to be the case anymore. How can we get back to the comfort level where both sides understand that, you know, yes, you know, these people you see, these people you don't, there are the people that come just to visit here. Can we make sure they're treated fairly and nicely? And I just liked what I had saw when I got here and went to. And I'd really like to see that continue because I personally got to see it work very well. And I believe Chief Hill when he says he wants, or that he's heard this enough that he wants to work with that. And so I'm absolutely willing to help in any way I can get there. And from the community aspect as well, get us to, you know, not in no way ignore what's happening nationally, but appreciate maybe what we do have locally and try to be an example of what surrounding areas could start to become if we can be that example, maybe show them by creating something here where it's starting to show that, oh, okay, if the police work with the community like this, it may start to show, so. Yeah, I don't know, the preacher's kid, I'll go on.
Hey, we should have the Judy.
Yeah,
I really
do, thanks,
Judy. Oh, yeah, forgive me, yeah.
No, no, you're good.
I had logistical issues for a second there. Do you want to pass, or see the direction?
So Judy, as the clerk, helps us make sure that we're all the committees and task force of council are bound by Sunshine Law. And no, Judy is the keeper of explaining how it all works.
So this is really simple, actually. It only gets complicated if you overthink. The whole idea about Sunshine Law is that it literally means to shine the light on anything that a public body is doing so that there's access to information, there's access to anything that public body is doing. You have now become a public body because you are in the position of gathering information, distilling ideas, processing those ideas, and reporting back to council. So by virtue of the fact that you are doing that, you are now a public body and subject to Sunshine Law. You have nine full members?
We have nine members and two alternates.
Okay, so your quorum is five people. So anytime that you have five...
If council people don't count? Because we're 12 total.
Well, there's two alternates and Mary Ann. Open meetings, what does that say?
Open meetings.
These are open meetings.
Open meetings.
It's probably confusing.
Yeah. Is that right?
Oh, I get complicated. I was going for the figure eight from the same name.
You said it wasn't complicated. No, just say that it is the open meeting, you do.
Yes.
So this is the other.
Oh, let's see.
So is this just
let's say one for Nia.
Is this what was sent out?
Yeah.
There was a link.
It was in the
And there was actually
And then, and I included in there that you guys can do it what you will, but there's the information just from council about boards and commissions and the ethical stuff like that, and then a little
that was the thing that we signed.
Yeah, so that's yours because it comes back to you when you get to that. Did anybody go to the link on Sunday? Kate's already done this, so
yeah, I did. I was read it
through. Awesome! awesome.
She posted it on Facebook. I put it on Facebook. I was developing questions.
Fantastic! That is outstanding. I actually tried to get on. I was just going to go through the whole thing today, and it was down. Go back and do it.
Yes.
There you go. There was probably a huge amount of information you just never knew.
Yeah, it was
because there's a lot about public records that you don't need to know. Really, as far as public records go, for your purposes, anything you disseminate is a public record. So if you want to send around something that says, you know, secretly, I think we need to disband the police force and get some new folks in here. It is not going to be a secret for longer than about 15 seconds. So just that, anything you disseminate becomes, you know, open for public information.
So if we disseminate anything, we should send you a copy. If we
wanted
to share.
You don't absolutely have to. It's just that if anyone said, hey, I want to know everything that they looked at that meeting, I would say, hey, I need to get everything you passed around at that meeting and then get it and give it to them. It's not a mandate that it's got to be
spread out there for everyone's consumption, but it has to be made available if anyone asks for it.
I'm just saying that might be the simplest way, because it would just include you.
Mm-hmm. That's a simple way to do it. The other end of it, and this is...
Are minutes kept on a file?
That's the thing I was going to say. Probably one of the first things you'll do is choose a secretary or unfortunate, whoever you are, and then that person is charged with keeping accurate meeting minutes. And in saying accurate, don't send me anything that isn't approved, because I can't use it, I can't do anything with it. So you can send it around for folks to look at. Don't comment on it, don't send it back, don't nothing. Bring it to your meeting, and then you'll go over it, make any corrections, and send the final version to me, and then I'll post it, and it'll be made available then to anyone who needs it. But there's a very good reason for not posting anything before it's approved. There was an example of another commission that met. Some folks had a side conversation. They put the side conversation into the minutes. Everyone else at the meeting went, "What? That was never discussed." Well, it wasn't discussed in the context of the meeting, so it needed to come out of the minutes. That was a sidebar that shouldn't have been. So you have to sort of check for those things when you read the minutes. As far as talking about stuff, which is tempting, you're doing something that's exciting, it's interesting, you're going to see other folks who go, "Oh my God, I really wanted to talk to you about an article I read, I want to process some ideas about this meeting that we just had." It's very tempting to do that, and you can do it with one other person or two other people. You can have those conversations. As soon as you get up to the number of quorum, it stops. You cannot go further. And that includes emailing. So you can fall into that toll so easily. You send out an email saying, I really thought the idea that Jennifer came up with was great. And then everyone responds, "Yeah, me too, I thought that was awesome. Oh yeah, and I read some." Whoa, suddenly you're violating sunshine law, because you are all sharing information about a topic and no one else has access to it. So anytime you send out, "I thought Jennifer's idea was great and I want to see more on it," put on it. So if you find something, bring it to the meeting, but don't reply to me. Just put something on that says, "Don't reply. Just know that I wanted you to have this information for the meeting." There's also, you also can't round robin, which I'm sure you learned about, which is I could email Kate and say, "I really liked what Jennifer had to say," and then Kate emails John and says, "Dude, I really liked what you had to say," and then John goes, "Oh, actually, see, can't do that either," because it achieves the same effect. And it's very simple if you just look at it as, if you're inside a backyard having a dinner party, and there's all the neighbors are looking over the fence going, "What are they eating? It looks pretty good. What are they talking about? Because I wasn't invited at all." They need to know what you're eating, what you're talking about, and if somebody goes to the bathroom, four other people better not go with them, because they're like, "Oh, they're talking about some stuff, and we don't know." Basically, everybody's just looking over that fence going, "What are they eating? What are they talking about?" And you need to make sure it's accessible to them. So that's the very most simple way to explain that. The embarrassing things that can happen are things like, "I heard from Al that you guys talked about this in your meeting. I'm going to look at those minutes. I don't see it. Al said you guys talked about it. You know what? I'm going to make a public records request. I want all emails for all members of the commission having to do anything to do with this particular topic." Now y'all got to turn over all your stuff. And we get all of it. We get your personal email to Basim saying, "Judith's idea sucked. Oh, everybody." I mean, that's the embarrassing part of it, because even something innocuous suddenly, is out there flying in the public. So, the watchword is, better safe than sorry. If you have any thought that it might be violating sunshine law, you can ask me. You can also go online to the website that you were on, and you can just check. There's frequently asked questions. You can check and ask a question. You can also email directly to the Attorney General's office and just say, I have this situation. And they'll either say, ask your attorney, which is usually what they say, or they may say, well, case law says this, and throw you something back. So you have options other than asking me. But in general, if you're having a meeting, it's got to be publicly noticed. So if you decide on Tuesday, holy cow, we have got to have a meeting before there's a big hire that takes place in the village, we have to meet on Thursday. Well, the paper comes out Thursday, so we can't do that. That's doesn't give people enough time to get to the meeting and be fully informed that you're having it and what it's about. So about a week ahead is a
so it has to be in the paper?
It has to be.
Okay.
Yeah.
This paper.
The Yellow Springs News, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's actually the requirement. Yellow Springs News, and then we put it on the website, which is not actually a requirement, but the whole notion is put it out as many places as possible so people can attend. I mean, bottom line is you want people to attend, and if they have any interest in the topic, they need to know that you're meeting, what you're talking about, and have the opportunity to attend. Which also means you keep the doors open. If you decide, oh my God, it's way crowded in here, we gotta go down to A and B, you put a big note on the door. We are in A and B, and leave the doors open.
The earliest that we could schedule a regular meeting, or a special meeting, but obviously we're not going to have emergent circumstances, so ignoring emergency meetings, would be what, like, since we meet on Tuesdays, would be like 9 days to the Thursday or 10 days to the Friday?
We meet on Tuesdays. So I would have to get it in the paper for the Thursday paper, which the absolute latest is Tuesday morning of the preceding week, so...
Right. So so the paper would come out 9 days later on Thursday. No. On Thursday.
The paper would come out 2 days later.
But it wouldn't... there is no way we could get it in from Tuesday. Tuesday meeting.
They still like
it. No, because it's in the evening, that's what he's saying. Because our meeting's in the evening.
Tuesday evening.
It wouldn't get... You wouldn't be able to put it until probably Tuesday.
Oh, yeah. No, so that's why you want your regular time. But if you met on a Tuesday and you were like, oh, crap, we've got to meet on...
As soon as possible.
As soon as possible would be the following, like, Friday. the next Friday, I'm sorry.
Cool, so like 10 days.
So, yeah. And it's, I mean, people find that they're extremely frustrated by that, but on the flip side, if somebody wanted to attend and participate and was like, what the hell? I didn't even get the paper and you guys already met. Similar frustration on there, so that's
kind of... Absolutely. I was actually in a committee once that decided that just flagrantly violated Sunshine. It, like, formed an executive committee with, like, outside of any meeting, and then had that executive committee schedule, like, meetings that it didn't tell its own members about. It was, like...
But was it a government? Oh,
yeah, it was a community council.
Oh, ouch. Wow, that's very bad. Don't tell me anything more.
It's probably past action limitations. And besides, we made a public record of, like, noting that we violated it, so, like, it was acknowledged that violation happened.
That level of diligence? It's like, okay. Has anyone other than Pat and Kate gone online to do the training or just checked it out?
I went to the site you said, but it just went to the manual, and I started reading it, and after about 40 pages, I quit, and Pat sent me the link that goes to the interactive. But I haven't gotten
it. I did the manual one, and I don't know if I made it about 30 pages.
Maybe I see
you. Well, I kind of skipped through it, but
there's some confusion.
I'm waiting through it all.
Yeah, because you can find the place where.
Off to the right, it says that there's an online training.
I meant the manual that was given to us.
I got those hard copy ones. Are you talking about
that? Yeah, those.
That,
you're like old school.
Even before those, yeah, no, there was the ones that we got in a packet.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, right. That's yeah. what I read through, and it said where to go for looking for specific things. It was pretty well done.
You gotta take a long.
No, but yeah, you're saying it to do
and you can't like, skip.
You know, it's way easier online. I mean, there's sections that just don't apply.
It is, but don't,
okay, gotcha.
But don't pause. Really? If you pause it in the middle of a section, it starts back at the beginning. I watched the same section like
so just
four times.
Make sure you have time.
Little 15-minute chunks. It's
in chunks, and some of them are just 5 minutes, and some are 20 minutes. The longest one is probably 20 minutes.
It took
so you
me
can
like
do
six,
three
months.
Or four, and then stop.
You can't save your progress.
You can.
Yeah, you can.
Okay,
I did it for months. I got frustrated because it had nothing to do with.
Yeah,
how long?
Little chunks.
Yeah, it's way less painful to just, you know, take the training about six times instead of just reading.
Is this the link in here, the one you're taught that we should use?
No,
you sent it in an email.
That didn't take you to it.
Well, can we circulate the link again?
Yep.
That'd be cool.
If we form small working groups that are smaller than five.
What's our magic number? Five.
So it's five.
Five is your core.
You know,
we can do that.
Yeah, well, there is very dependent on that, but if that working group is tasked not with, we need you to go out, gather the information, process it, come back and tell us what we need to do, but
no
go
decision
out,
making.
Gather, process, come back, and then we will discuss it as a large group. Yes, because then you haven't left anybody looking over the fence gets to hear it when you bring it back and have the discussion. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you went into the living room away from where they could see you and came back and said, we should definitely do A instead of B. And they don't know why. So as long as you're just coming back and saying, here's all the stuff we talked about, and here's why we think we should tell council to do A instead of B, and then Kate can say, I totally disagree with that. What were you guys thinking? And then someone else
the decision
can say,
isn't being made in these small groups.
Right. So that way.
Because we may want to have small working groups.
And that also makes it a lot easier on the person who's taking minutes. Right, but then you've got it, and it's in the minutes, so if anybody needs to go back and go, why on earth did we assign that? There it is. You got it. It's all right there. Does anybody have questions about anything?
I wanted to mention, too, I don't think it's going to happen with this group, but you can accidentally violate a sunshine law if you're online. I was part of those, too, and so was our liaison, council liaison, and we wrote something on some kind of thread, and then I went to bed, and in the morning I realized that I violated it because like four other people commented from our same commission, including our liaison, and so
the HRC.
Yeah, and so it was a violation.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I was kind of frustrated because I was like, I didn't violate it. I went to bed.
See, you can violate stuff even worse.
Because if they had, I would have rushed and deleted my thing, you know, if I had counted, because then in the morning I counted and I was like, oh.
That is a really good point, because the whole internet phenomenon makes it
Facebook, I think.
If you're discussing something, some issue.
Well, even, I don't think she was initially discussing something, she just said, here's what I think, and then because other people from the commission jumped on and said, me too, or I just, it started being a discussion in the thread without her.
It was a good learning experience,
so
I guess.
She thinks about knocking on, what is it, Facebook? Or what is it? I don't even know.
Yeah,
well,
I think
so.
Yeah, but it's not just about a topic you know. Like, I thought maybe it was about a topic that you had some sort of whatever.
If it's not something being discussed by the commission, you can discuss other things.
I don't think you can, though.
It has to have nothing to do with it.
I'm saying,
right.
It doesn't
well,
have
this,
to do.
This,
oh, but it did, you're saying.
Well, I don't know.
I mean,
but,
like,
you know,
would
we
have
should say that the one reason that we're having
terrible.
This level of concern about it is that, we hope this wouldn't happen in the Alice Springs, but people sue, and they can sue.
Yeah.
They can actually cause harm, you know, to our village council, our government, and they can get money suing, saying you violated it, so let's be cautious about that.
That's why I would just not talk about it, it has to.
Not from that.
Or something.
Public record perspective.
The justice system, if we're not talking about, we're talking about gardening.
Right.
As long as it's not marijuana.
As long as it doesn't get controversial down towards the end of the thread, and then it blows up.
This could really happen, because if, you know, if there were some police action that blew up on Facebook.
Yes, that is.
Yeah, you.
Some reason for not commenting.
You cannot comment.
It's hard not to comment sometimes.
I would say that, yeah, for safety, you cannot comment. And not only for safety reasons, but because you now have this sort of elevated level of interest and access. You now have access to council on a level that you did not before you were on the commission, and that's the thing that people look at and go, okay, wait, I disagree with her, and I know that she's on this commission that's going to go make a report to council, and I disagree with her, and that's not okay with me. Now it's agitating. Like, well, wow, now you have this other voice, and you're able to reach back out to the community and say, from my position of authority on this committee, I disagree with this police action. That may not be your intention at all. But that's the perception.
That's welling up of power when I got this letter.
It's up on you, man. It just does.
But how can I run a secret cabal if I can't talk to everybody?
Well, exactly. I mean, I want to be a little careful in that. People, for example, the old days, wrote letters to the editor and had individual opinions about things. And as members of our committee, you can speak as an individual and write that letter. That's not going to be, there could be a debate in the, is that not right? I mean, council does. We write letters. We're speaking for ourselves.
Yeah, pretty carefully, though. I mean, I would say within this group could fall apart pretty quickly if Kate decides this is how she feels, and she's not getting enough voice or agreement within the group, so now she's going to write a letter to the editor. Uncool. If what your end goal is your charge is as a group to make recommendations to council about a particular thing. If you jump that fence, jump the process, and write the letter to the editor, you're jumping ahead of your group and making a recommendation saying, Village of Yellow Springs, this is what I think should actually happen. And then everyone's
about
going,
this.
Wait, I thought you were still engaged in debate
that's
and information gathering.
But that's separate from the legal question.
Well, I was going to say, I mean, for council members, we're elected officials, we are sometimes organizing citizens for a particular perspective, which as an elected person,
legally this affects the committee in exactly the same way that it affects council, and so we're in exactly the same position, and we can all write letters to the editor on committee topics, and because they're letters to the editor, they are highly public, and therefore it can't possibly violate sunshine.
But you can certainly violate the charge of your commission, which is you're supposed to be collaborative and working with one another to come to kind of a consensus. And even if the consensus is, final report out to council is, we did not achieve consensus. We had 4 people who really think this and 5 people who really think that, and that is our report to council instead of, every week I see, and boy, is that commission a mess. Man, they can't even agree with each other. Why am I going to go tell them what I
think? That is definitely
so, but that's not, no one's going to see you for it. It's just going to engender some ill will, so that's your choice.
I don't want to sit in my life, so.
Are there any more questions on that? There may be as we kind of go along, but I think maybe that seems like a good place to stop. Anything on this?
Okay.
So we can have
if you take the train, you send me a ticket.
Oh, you're
most welcome.
Carrie, do you want to take this?
Oh, yeah.
I'll try to sign her papers. Thanks.
Awesome.
Yeah.
John, did you get one?
Is that an actual?
I thought I'd give it
to you. Can we sign a different one for this or
that? Yeah, it's different level.
Yeah, because I chose a separate file. So awesome.
All right. No, I don't.
So this is a
good one? Do you need a pen?
You know what? I'm gonna have to check, and I'll send a good one out.
Okay.
Because, you know, it's easier just to click it from the email than it is.
Yeah, that makes, yeah, that makes sense.
Yes.
Good job. No, no, no. Yeah. Yeah.
Justice system. Justice village.
Oh, yeah, what is the term then?
There is no ending term.
The 18th, there's two.
Oh, okay. So I guess just the state.
I just put.
Thank you. Thank you.
Probably a big.
Okay. Well, perhaps we should get back to our going around the table and then, yeah. Sorry, I'm pressing.
My name is Sam Wood and I'm married to Toy. Toy Lane, she's a nurse in intensive care. She does dispatch occasionally.
You can just slide it in the door.
Is that right?
Yeah.
My son.
Oh, I will try to remember. Thank you.
The summer in that, sorry, in that. Where parents of Malcolm, the sixth grader at Lausanne, and we're on the PTO at Lausanne. And Malcolm is the youngest of seven, so we have six adult children. All over the country from Seattle to Washington, D.C. And we've been living in Yellow Springs since 2013. I think the third week we were here was the shooting on High Street, right in our backyard.
Yeah.
And
literally.
We immediately thought we made a mistake. Wow, this is not what we thought Yellow Springs was going to be like. But we got, you know, after learning about the situation and the situation nationally, we're concerned and we try to just be supportive in any way we can to make the village a wonderful place. And we're very glad that we live here and we have great neighbors. And I'd like to serve on this committee to help out in any way I can make the Yellow Springs a great place to live. So I'm excited to be here.
My name's Ellis Jacobs. I've lived here for maybe 25 years, a while. I mean, by small town standards, I'm a new resident, relatively new resident.
How old are you? Did you say 20?
30.
Oh,
30. My son went to high school here, and I've had some really good experiences with the police, and I've also been aware of other people having really bad experiences. There's something I remember at a point when John and you were doing all your agitating about, you know, the police overreacting. I remember my son being stopped for having one of the two lights over his rear license plate out. One of the two lights over his rear license. So in other words, the license plate was fully illuminated. It was just a pretext for something. You know, dogs and the whole thing. And I kind of thought, whoa, what's going on here? And so we've sort of seen, you know, swings in the police department, and this seems like a really good opportunity to try to make something great happen in a little town. In the last couple of years, we've all learned a whole lot about policing in America. There's been some great work done, and we have the opportunity to build on it. So I'm really looking forward to working with everybody here. My personal background in the area is that I've been a lawyer for about 25 years. When I started out, I was a public defender, doing nothing but criminal defense work for about 5 years. And you really learn a lot about the criminal justice system from that perspective. I still do public interest, civil rights type law. I represented the folks concerned with the buses at Beaver Creek. I've organized the legal observers for the John Crawford demonstrations. And that kind of stuff I continue to do. And I'm working on some other police-related issues elsewhere in the Miami Valley right now, and we'll probably continue to do that. I've been on the Planning Commission and on the board, and presently on the Board of Zoning Appeals, and you know, it's a great opportunity to be able to get some stuff done in the village. And, I mean, that's the wonderful thing is that you get the sense that you can actually accomplish, you know, you did a lot of that. So I'm looking forward to seeing what we can accomplish.
My name's Pat Louise, and I lived in Yellow Springs from 76 to 81, when my kids went to Amherst School. I worked at Renee Laboratories, however it is. So I had some sense of that kind of somewhat idealized Yellow Springs that used to be. And I understand people's nostalgia about that, but of course we do live in really different times now. I've carried a concern about the justice system nationally and state of Ohio and locally for, I would say, decades, partly because of my own Quaker background, because the Quakers are activists in prison reform. We have a lobby in Washington that is right now pushing for legislation to end mandatory sentencing. So I'm having some sobering thoughts about shutting up. Because I've been vocal about a lot of these issues. So I moved back here after retiring from the George Voinovich Institute for Leadership and Public Affairs at Ohio University. Those of you who remember George Voinovich. So I've been here almost 5 years again, and I did participate in the work that the council did about pulling out of the Green County Combined Task Force, Drug Task Force. And I thought that was very well done. I mean, I think that the council did a really great job in terms of creating public forums, and citizens were pretty civil and talking about the issues and trying to understand the issues. And I felt Chief Hale was pretty great about showing up and listening to things he probably didn't want to listen to. So I thought that was a positive, really positive outcome. And then when I saw this was happening, I thought, well, for me, this is a chance to get past all of my protesting and negative letters and, okay, now what, you know, which I wish there have been many. Okay, so what is the situation? What is happening? And is there something we could do to make it more like how we want it to be? So I think it's a kind of a, you know, it's a positive. All of you have just said, we have an opportunity to really look at how we can now think through what is it we want in terms of community policing. What does that look like? And what would we have to do to make it happen?
I don't think it will silence you on the national level, though.
Sorry?
I don't think being on this silences you on the national level with letters and things
right,
like that.
Right.
I don't think it silences your voice.
Yeah.
It hasn't silenced mine.
I was going to say there's some pieces of that that we're just going to have to find clarity as we go along.
Yeah.
But I do think, as you said, that the being on, okay, it's a commission to look at the Justice Task Force, it sort of does put you in a different place. The perception, if you're out there writing a lot of letters or organizing or whatever. Yeah, so something to think about.
Well, many of you said what I was going to say. My son graduated in 89. Eric Schleter.
And he was
a big factor in why I wanted to be part of this, because I talked to him quite a bit. He was back here for the 4th of July, for a week over the 4th of July. And when I talked to him about his perception of the police, it's totally different than when I talked to the kids at the high school or some of John's comments. So I asked him, what's the difference? He said he was never stopped. He never felt he was profiled or anything. Why? And he had his perception of police as they were there to help him. And I said, why is that? He said, Nipper, Pierce, and Banner had kids that were in my class or close to my class. And so they, you know, they all knew him, and they knew he wasn't the troublemaker. And so I've talked to Chief Hale about, you know, doing something to an incentive to get the police officers to stay in town. I mean, what Steve was talking about, things are very different now, I perceive, than was back then. And then, you know, Eric's African American, said he lives in South Carolina, and there have been all of these incidents on there. So he's done a whole bunch of things. Like he says he puts his car registration over the visor in his car because he doesn't want to have to reach into the glove compartment. And then, you know, he's really conscious of changing his behavior in order to not put himself in the position of what's happened. So I really am excited about the possibilities of you know, of this group, and I think we can maybe get back or help develop the community policing to get a positive dynamic like there used to be. And my perception of Chief Hale is he's just missing. And I think, I mean, the other, you know, thing that I'm sure a lot of you have read the new Jim Crow book. I mean, this had a huge impact on me, and I think all the police officers should be required to read that. And the other book that I really recommend, that if you want to understand the drug war, this is an extraordinary book, Chasing the Scream, The First and Last Days of the War on Drugs. I mean, this gave me some insights that I had no idea. So I've been doing a lot of reading and trying to, but part of what I need is to find out some of the things the police are doing, because I had some ideas. I mentioned one to Mary Ann, and she said, oh, they're already doing that. So, you know, there's some things that I would like to be aware of that. So, anyway, I'm really excited to be part of the group, and I have great hopes that we can have an impact.
Did you say your name?
Huh?
Did you say your name?
Oh, I'm Al Schweiger.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah. I've been here since 1970, so I've lived here a long time.
You are a teacher? Is that your background?
Yeah, I was a college chemistry teacher, taught at Central State, and I taught at Tougaloo College in the 60s, and then down in Mississippi, and then I've taught in Africa on 8 or 9 different times in various places. So I've been retired for so long that it doesn't seem like a different life. After I retired, I was on the Miami Township Fire and Rescue, so I did that for about 12 years, and just as a pure volunteer, and I enjoyed that very much.
And you still have the most awesome vegetable garden on
Now I am a farmer, yeah. I have a great big garden on High Street, the second house there, so if you need any tomatoes, let me know.
Yeah. I'm Mary Ann, and I moved here in the early 70s, and I also coordinated the mediation program for 6 years, in about 90 to 96, during which time we had one forum on the police, community forum, and we also had some meetings with regarding police and young people. So I can say that even though we did know the police, there's always been tension between the police and the community, off and on from time to time. The thing that is new now, I think, is that we're having not only are our officers not living here, there's a pretty rapid turnover, it seems like. So even if they don't, you know, they're not even getting a chance to know people, I don't think. I ran for council, Barb, in my third year on council. And when I was running for council, John organized a little meeting that I attended. And these little meetings that I attended, especially with young people, the issue of the drugs and us being in the drug task force came up. And then when I got on council pretty early on, Kate came to a council meeting and said something, and which gave an opening to say, okay, let's start looking at the drug task force. So I worked on getting us out of the drug task force, and as Judith said, also with Brian Hausch, developed the vision statement for the police.
And we got a SWAT, too.
Yes, that had already happened, yeah, I think that had happened.
Got out of SWAT, you said?
Yeah, because one of the meetings I went to, I said, well, we're on SWAT as well, and then council was like, what?
I think the chief at the time made that decision. I don't think that's council that made that decision.
To get off of it?
I think you understood.
I don't know, anyways. But you were.
So, anyway, the idea of looking at how the police function and educating the community, too, and as well as with the mayor's court and the degree that we can incorporate restorative justice principles within our system and keep as much as possible cases within the community that if we can handle them well and that appropriate be kept in the community, I think that makes sense. So I'm glad that we're finally getting started on this. I don't know if I don't know that I'll come to all the meetings. I don't know. We'll just have to see the link. But I'm available.
And you're the HRC liaison?
Yes, yeah.
I'm David Turner. Most of you know me. I've seen you in another meeting, I think. And I've done work in at least half of your houses. So. I think that there are some real and imagined concerns that exist in this community, you know, the cost tension between the police and the village officials and the residents. There's some, certainly they're significant, and there are a lot of them, or some of them at least, that are minor distractions, as with any issue. I think resolving issues to work to improve communication between everybody, put in place a clear understanding of what people want and don't want, for the police, the mayor's court, et cetera, like many of you have said, is the only way to really deal with it. I'm an engineer by nature, by training. I've got over 40 years experience in working with all kinds of things. I'm a consensus-driven food co-op all the way to Milton when I was in the military. I've been on the board of YSI, board of the NAM school, and PTO. I tutor kids in math in my grade school and in high school. I'm retired, but I've got a self-employed in a repair business. And I've designed, built varied products, and written and implemented policies and procedures, and done training, and I've done dealt with regulatory issues from local to international, for-profit, not-for-profit. So I've done a lot of things with a lot of different people. And I have good communication skills, I find, because I've got to work with the people who don't have much education, and the people who have far more than I do, and everybody in between. Another thing that I think is key is that, if you know me, you've probably seen this one at least once or twice. Now that I look like the old guy that I'm becoming, I've decided to embrace minor promotion. I think the key is to work on what's on the table in front of us and listen to people and try and understand what other people have to say, even if I really disagree with them, on something. Because to me, getting the kind of things done that we're all talking about is important. I think being able to focus on the limitations of what we have and avoiding the distractions is really important. I remember probably 10 years ago, leaving yet another form in Yellow Springs, I think it was an education, and I'm driving along in the car all by myself, and I said out loud, I don't know why I keep coming to these things. Because it was the same people saying the same thing. Imagine, if we all just had numbers, we could hold up the number and everybody know what we were going to say. But I really believe it's important to participate in the community, and so I focus on things that I think are important and I think can have an impact. And I suspect that this is, and I'm glad to see this bunch of people. This is exciting to have this possibility. But at the same time, I think that we have a community that's got a lot of people who want to believe things without getting new evidence, and we're going to stick to their guns. And so battling people who want the impossible, battling people who want things that are unrealistic or not worth paying attention to or spending a lot of energy on may be harder than, you know, than some of the more important issues. The one topic, for instance, that keeps coming up is police officers living in town. In the good old days when it was different than ideal. 100,000 years ago, you know, this was a different place, and we're not there now. And 10 years ago is the same thing. I should be treated the same when I go to Fairborn as when I'm in Yellow Springs by the police, I believe. And so I think it's a little bit of a distraction to focus too much energy on the residency of the police. I think the attitude and behavior of the police is key, because if I'm in Fairborn and I'm treated like shit, I'm getting treated like shit. You know, if I'm treated decently, I'm getting treated decently, no matter where I am. So I think it's more important to focus on trying to, on being sure that the police in Yellow Springs treat everybody with respect, fairly and reasonably, no matter who you are, resident or non-resident, young or old. And that's the kind of magic I'm doing.
I'm Jennifer Berman, and I am, let's see, this time around, I've been in Yellow Springs for 8 years, I think, maybe 9, and before that, I lived in Xenia for about 6 years or so, and back in the 80s, I was a student at Antioch. I graduated in 84, I was community manager in 85. And then we moved back to Xenia and had a little farm there in 2000, and then moved here. So yeah, we've been back about 16 years, which makes me even newer here than Ellis. I have two kids, 11 and almost 14, and they both go to public school here. I work at the college. I started a restorative justice program there. I'm very interested in incorporating that here. I think it could do a lot of good and could be very doable, and it could keep a lot of stuff out of the courts, and sort of grow community while we're at it, because the whole point of restorative justice is not to figure out what crime someone committed and what the punishment is, but what harm was done and what can be done for that person, the offender, to re-enter the community and everyone feel good about it. So it's a really great process. I absolutely love it. I also have, you know, I have this teenage son who's starting to feel his oats and run around town at around 10 or 11 at night with his buddies and play fugitive, and I am very concerned that the police don't know this group of boys, and they need to, especially in light of how, you know, quick on the trigger police can be. It really scares me to have him run around, and yet we moved to Yellow Springs so that he could have this kind of idyllic childhood. I think the Paul Shank thing really shifted my feelings about police in the community. And I felt like, maybe unlike Dave, I felt like if the police knew the family, they would have more information to work with, and he might not have been killed. One of the things I dearly loved about Chief Grody was that he would always open the door for every single kid who went to Mills Lawn. And it was such a brilliant way of him getting to know every kid in this community. And I would really love to see more police officers be part of the community and really have a deep understanding of the people here and feel like they had a stake with the people in the community, and that these were their friends and their, you know, peers. And, so I do feel like police from the community is something I feel very passionate about. I think that's it.
Cool.
Awesome.
I'm Judith Hemplin, member of the council. I didn't actually think about what I was going to say, so I'm just going to, whatever comes up. But I was on the council 8 years, and I was off two, now I'm back on. Those first 8 years, during that period, I was concerned as a council member around issues of civil liberties. And it was also a time I read and heard Michelle Alexander interviewed on the New Jim Crow, which was horrifying to hear about. And there was also another fellow who participated in that interview, Southern, they work with people on death row and have, I think it's the Innocence Project, it was related to the Innocence Project. But at that time, council did not think it was its place to provide any policy for the police. I brought it to council, we really got berated. for example, Chief Crowdy came wanting to start using taser. Well, what happened was it was just in our budget to buy tasers. And I was concerned because I was reading enough stories about people being killed with tasers. And I know that it's really important that you have good policy if you're going to start using tasers. At that time, council, like I say, what do you know about policing? You know nothing. You know, it was kind of, there was just a very strong attitude that we, the public, I mean, me, even an elected official, had no right, how dare I, think that I should have, we should have any say as even elected officials or have a public discussion about the works of our police department. That's where things were a few years ago. Things have changed very dramatically in these last several years. You know, we've all been living through, you know, the militarization of our police, which is also very concerning, again, civil liberties, you know, the institutional racism in our criminal justice system, Michelle Alexander so strongly and effectively. It made me quite sick. And so I felt like we should try to do something and brought some little things to council. Have also thought I could be wrong, but have felt we're over-policed. I think there's also over-policing, which and also the way that affects the budget of the village, you know, the amount of money we spend on our police department. And that's not being critical in any particular way, it's just a question of how much can a small community afford. And what there was that, when I first came on council, we were voting for our new tax, people were, some of our staff was basically threatening we were going to be closing the pool, we were going to be closing the library, if we didn't pass this tax, and I don't know if you guys remember that, and some of you do, I'm sure. And but you know, we were spending over 50% of our budget on police department, and I started looking at sort of other small towns around. What are they spending on their police departments? What does it take to really keep us safe? And so I don't have really answers, but that those are the kind of questions I've also been interested in. You know, as now a member of council again, you know, for a small community, that whole question of what can we afford, and you know, so anyway, I've been interested in this for a while, and then the time finally came right for actually was I think Mary Ann and HRC and with the whole discussions on the ACE Task Force, suddenly the time was right. People were open to thinking about these questions, and so when we brought the idea of having the task force council, there was no question council was in support of it. And there's a lot to be done, I think, and so really the next question is kind of how do we get it accomplished and how do we get started. One thing I do want to say is that we have one member who's missing tonight. Her name is Nia Stewart. She's going to be a junior in high school. And she and we had talked about wanting really, you know, young people, the high school, to have some representation on this committee. And one of the faculty there who I had called and sort of asked, how do we get to students who, you know, would be independent thinking and that might have an interest, so she put some feelers out and identified two young women, they're close friends. One is a student from Beaver Creek who comes into the Yellow Springs system. But they want to work on it together. So it's Ayanna Madison and Nia Stewart are the two people. Nia Stewart is going to be the member of our committee. She's already been, council has put her on the committee. And so they're playing soccer and things like that. But so they're going to try to, but they knew they were going to miss this meeting. But Ayanna, when Nia can come and Ayanna can come, she won't be a voting member, but they want to be a liaison to the high school, to the junior high and high school students, and to bring their input that might be relevant. They thought there might be a place for us to speak to the high school, have discussions with them potentially. I mean, who knows what could happen. But they want to do it as part of their schoolwork.
Judy, I forgot to say that I was born and raised in Ferguson, Missouri.
Oh, my God. And
so I just want to.
That's your fault, Doug.
Wow. Well, that's interesting. Okay, so enough on that. So that was great. I'm really interested in hearing what everybody shared. And I think we should just take a few minutes to think about next steps and next meeting. And actually, can I just hand it over to you,
sure.
Pat? Because Pat was, we were going to recommend that Pat lead the next meeting on this idea of developing a work plan. And so I'm going to let her take over.
I guess I'll just also say that from the work that I did at an applied research and technical assistance institute that worked with local governments and nonprofits in the 30 counties of Ohio Appalachia, that I had to do a lot of different work plans and project management and facilitation at public meetings like zoning meetings in Southern Ohio and watershed restoration, and I mean I've just done a lot of those, so I have some sense of how we can somewhat efficiently anyway next meeting go through what is actually quite a bit of work. I don't know if that's hitting you yet. But I think, we want to be clear about the deliverables, and we want to be clear about what it's going to take to get there and have the timeline and a reporting schedule and, all those kinds of nitty-gritties of a work plan. And I think we had the idea that between, to make sure we didn't do nothing between now and the next meeting, without violating the sunshine laws, I hope, we can be in smaller groups, three or four?
We thought we could have, if we had three groups.
Okay, so we'll count off. And so the group that you end up in, the idea is to find a time you could get together and really, for your small group, really look hard at this charge, the committee charge. And I think what you want to do then is bring back some of the questions, as well as some thoughts about your own skills and interests, which parts of this playing this whole big piece of work is of most interest to you, and thoughts about resources. So, for example, if you start to answer the question, how does the mayor's court differ from the county court? Well, the questions that come up are, how would we figure that out? How would we know that? Would we have to go to the courts? Would we have public records? Would we have to do interviews?
Yeah, well, here's the resolution.
I don't know that we would.
Does everybody know?
Is it on the resolution? The questions?
No.
Oh, it's just questions here.
Okay.
We're all like scribbling.
I'm taking an example out of task force research.
Yeah.
There's a list of things.
Right.
Are there any more copies?
Yep.
Yes.
So the assignment for the small group is that you get together sometime before our next meeting and you really carefully go through the committee charge and just sort of generate some of the questions that you're going to bring back for our meeting, which would be a working meeting. We will work to come up with a work plan. That'll be a little, and you can, you know, pretty quickly, if you start digging into it, see the kinds of questions that will come up in terms of how do we do this, and how long will it take, and who will do it? So, you know, sort of those kinds of questions are going to surface for you, and you can bring them back to this work group.
Can I ask a question? Are there two deliverables here?
Well, there's more than two when you start getting into it, I'm sorry to say. For example, the first deliverable that Judith mentioned already is that there'll be a report, which might even be a public forum, to the council about what's going on now. That is, what is the status quo? What's happening? That's the first thing you mentioned. Obviously, the big deliverable is the recommendations in 2 years. But there's also deliverables hidden under how do we educate the public. That's a deliverable. Because how are you going to do that if you don't have events or... So looking at the goals and deliverables, the big things, and then under that, well, how do we get to that point? That's the kind of timeline.
Is it recommendations throughout this timeline or just at the end of 2 years?
Well, this is the end. A set of recommendations is brought forward. I mean, I don't think this is totally set in stone. I assume that this committee could say, wait a minute, we need to do this part of it now or that part of it later. But if you look at what's here right now, you know, you'll see at least three big, pretty big deliverables. Mm-hmm. And then each of them involve a lot of work. You know, and there is the question of what level. I mean, I think one thing I can contribute is that we're retired. We're more flexible. We can go sit in the courts. You know, I know a lot of people are working and very hard to do some of these things. But that is the question. Who is going to do this and how do we do it? And some of these things might just be public records. We could just ask Judy, can you find this for us? Or how do we do this? Or what kind of requests do we make for public records?
So since that's so clear that we'll be making public records requests, do we want to assign folks to start
making?
I mean, like, how much time would we have to spend in this meeting to just basically put ourselves in a position where people could be going out making public records requests between now and next meeting?
Oh, I don't think you want to do that. Okay. I don't think we're ready to do that.
Right.
I think we have to be clear about what it is we're trying to do.
Okay.
And then we have to find out which of these things could. And you've done it, so you know you can do public records, and that's one way some of this work will be done. But some of it can't be done that way.
Right.
There have to be interviews, observation, research. What do they do up the road in Granville? They have a very active mayor's club in Granville.
Was it?
Who wants to go to Granville? I mean, you know, so there's a lot of pieces here that are going to have to be kind of pulled apart. So I guess we should just count off and then figure out how they could get together between now and the next meeting to dig into that. Any other more comments or questions about how we're doing this?
Well, one thing, as a good comment, I think that, you know, the research and subsequent conversations, investigations, et cetera, would certainly inform us as to which direction to go, what kind of things to report and not, and the charges, as I read them, were not vague and meaningless, but very broad. And I would think that it reminds me of all of those seminars that I've been to where we divide up into groups and we're given some job to do, and the first 5 minutes of the 10 are spent saying, what are we supposed to do? And then the leader comes around and says, so what are you doing? We're confused. You're going to do a good job. Keep going. And then with 30 seconds left, you're going to cobble something together.
Now, are you referring to the small groups or the
whole? I'm talking about, you know, small groups and seminars and we're supposed to go learn something.
Are you talking about our assignment for right now?
About the way I see these things working. You know, it's not that it will work this way because we're a great bunch of people. In those circumstances, we don't have enough time. We're given an incomplete set of things to do. We're puzzled about what to do, and then we do something and feel uncomfortable about it. what I've discovered is that it's faster to say, all right, we're going to decide what we're going to do, and at the end, give the presentation to the whole group that we think is appropriate to give. And every time I've been able to get groups to do that, the people say, oh, that was good, you know, or adequate. So my point in mentioning and telling a long story is that we're going to do research, figure things out, and at some point, you know, come to conclusions that it would be reasonable to deliver this, this, and this to counsel the police, whoever, as opposed to what initially was charged, we were charged with. And so,
well, this is our starting point.
Right.
This is the charge from the council.
Right.
So I think we do have to do this work of looking at it.
Well, I'm not saying don't do the work. I'm saying
the work of looking at it.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
But,
we might come to your conclusion of, oh, we don't really need to do that, or let's check that out whatever. But the first
we will change
point,
what we're going to do as we go along.
Yes.
Figure it out.
But let's start where we're starting, which is we have to look at the charge.
Yeah, I've thought of this as someone who helped write it, as, you know, there's this first section, and then we give a report. And council actually, I think, thought at that time when they asked for, yeah, we'd like to have a report. And they wanted us to be kind of more specific, because, you know, because they were afraid we'd just get lost in terms of, as a committee, are we going to get any work done? It's going to be too broad. So we tried to be a little more specific. But I almost wonder, does it make more sense for the small groups to just discuss that first section and not the second? Because to me, because I know council expects when we give this report that they may have some other things they're going to ask of us, or, you know, that will lead into the second part. I mean, or I think potentially it's going to be a public, given publicly, the public's going to weigh in or have something to say, or maybe they won't. I don't know, maybe council won't, but it's possible. But I almost feel like the first section.
Well, you're considering
the first section.
What I'm talking about is what
first
is.
Section?
Oh, the regarding this current practices and policies.
That's right here?
Yes, up there.
Okay.
Well,
I thought we weren't. My sense is that. Sometimes when three people, for example, get together and look at this page, that you can start talking about, like, well, now what does this mean? Now should we do this before this? Or, oh, I have an idea. Why don't we? So it's a way of us grounding ourselves in this charge with three people, say, and coming back, and then start looking at, oh, how are we going to do this? Or, oh, I think this, so to start developing sort of a work plan.
Exactly. And I think, I'm not sure when I looked at it that there's such a distinction. For example, in the first clump, mayor's court history, blah, 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 and then in the second clump, the role of the mayor's court, the role of the prosecutor in the mayor's court.
Oh, this
yes, but if you look at
there's overlap.
But if you look at the sentence that comes right before the clumps, the first one says research regarding current practices and policies.
Right.
Will include but not be limited to. The second one says the task force will research best practices, innovative approaches, and justice system reforms.
Uh-huh.
So I think what Judy was suggesting was we could consider possibly in the breakout groups, and I think that maybe this is what Dave was trying to say too. Like if we narrowed it to saying that to just discussing what the work plan will be for gathering information on current practices and policies, and then the small groups wouldn't have to talk about also how we're going to research best practices.
Yeah, okay, so you're making the point that they are separate clumps.
They're theoretically separate clumps.
However, I still feel it would be better, first of all, just leave it up to the threesome to figure it out. And then the other reason for that would be that some people would say, I don't want to do any of this data gathering, hanging out in the court. I'd love to do the research. So somebody's going to come back waiting for that person to stand up and say me, and spend all their time in the library and do all the research for us. You're going to get a sense of what you want to do.
So you don't want to
we can't all do
yeah.
all of it.
Okay. So you don't want to chop it up into little things, like one group will focus on the first bullet and one you just want to look at the whole thing. Okay.
And that's what the whole group is going to do, really. So I think you should figure out. I mean, if you only get to this, go this far.
Right.
in your hour, hour and a half, then that's as far as you got, you know?
Also, I think what you were saying, it might be that this group would say, well, yeah, we see a role of prosecutor in mayor's court as in the second part, but we think it's important to be looking at it now. I mean, it might be that there would, that there's not going to be a big distinction between the first part and second.
Well, the argument would be that basically without a full understanding of the problems that are specifically existent in Yellow Springs, someone setting out to research best practices would be finding, you know, might be finding the wrong solutions because the problems haven't been specifically identified.
It could be. I mean, it is a really big scope of work, right? So I think, you know, just getting started with what is it and what do we feel ready to take on. So I think just trust the precinct to figure out what they want to talk, what they see as what comes up for them, like, oh, wow, that's going to be really hard, or I want to do that, or...
Well, I would think coming out of it would be a, you know, better understanding of, you know, what we think is important.
Right. Exactly.
And I think coming up with three or four things that are important instead of 20 or 30 things that are important would be easier.
Okay, well, if you're in the group with him, that's what's
going to be. I mean, we want the small groups to basically be coming up with, like, or this is one possible outcome, is that they would come up with, like, a list of subcommittees that need to be formed to do a set of tasks, right?
The main goal of being in the smaller group is that two things. One, we don't want a whole month to go by with nothing happens. Two, you want to come to the next meeting be feeling very informed about what we're being asked to do. You want to feel very grounded in the tasks that are here and whether or not you think they're the right ones and how much work it's going to take, and you feel really grounded in this charge. We could argue with the charge, go back to the council and say, oh, you missed this, or we don't want to do all that, but you have to know what it is first.
And it's a chance for us to get to know each other a little better.
Yeah, sure.
I think the group's too big to do it all and the group is whole.
Can I suggest that our groups come back with sort of similar sized lists? So that one person doesn't come back with 73 things and the other has three bullet points. I think that might help us, because I think we might be overwhelmed in our next meeting if we have,
Do you have a suggestion? I would say the first thing you want to come back with is, what do you think the big goals or deliverables are? I mean, I put out three, but you might say, oh no, there's only two, or there might be four. What are the big deliverables? Well, that's one thing.
Deliverables meaning outcomes?
Deliverable meaning that we're supposed to deliver to the council or to the public, whether it's a report or...
If each group comes back with six or fewer, then the next process would be finding, you know, common themes and culling it down to say three, just to pick two numbers. If we come back with a lot, but not too many, we can cull it down to a manageable number.
Wait, so are you suggesting we would actually be jumping the gun for the small groups to be discussing the process by which the goals would be accomplished? Or
no, to uncover in this charge that we were given what appears to be big goals or deliverables. And we can keep the conversation. I mean, this is just a starting point. This is not the end conversation. Mm-hmm. So,
did you have two other things that you wanted to face it?
Well, okay, so yeah, the big deliverables.
What's
going
to be uncovered? I mean, isn't it?
What, you know, why don't we just keep going? That's my suggestion.
I mean, yeah, I was going to say we can keep talking about it, but I think let's have that.
We'll figure it out once we get there.
Yeah.
Four groups of three? Is that what you're saying?
I was thinking two groups of four.
Okay.
But did you have two more points?
Yeah.
Sorry.
I thought you did. I thought you said there were three.
Maybe I did say that. I don't know. It's getting late for me. Okay. So, but the first one is just what do you see as the deliverables? What are the big things that are going to have to happen?
The other thing you said was, what are the things that any one of us are particularly interested in doing?
Yeah, what is your own?
Kate is good at research.
She might want to do that.
Right.
Steve is good at talking to someone.
Yeah.
What is your skill or gift or interest that you're going to bring into the process? That's something to check out with the other people. And then I think looking through the tasks in terms of just getting a sense of that when we come to, when we come to discussing them, you know, each of these bullet points is a task. And how do, what do we think about that task? How do we imagine it can happen? Is this a matter of interviewing? Is it a matter of, I mean, that we, you know, the small group doesn't have to decide that, but just sort of thinking about taking a look at it and talking about it as a group.
You know, another thing the small groups might do is think about resources outside of this group. Like, I know someone, well, I think Alice knows someone at UD who could do something. Jennifer knows how we could find out more about restorative justice views, whatever, to start bringing those resources on.
Well, it seems to me, I'm just thinking, looking at it myself, just as an example, if I were my own group, I'd say we need to focus on police hiring, mayor support, best practices, and drug control. And if everybody comes back, comes up with some of those, then we can look at it. That's, is that the kind of thing you're thinking about?
That's one way to start. Yeah, I'm not being too directive because I think the main thing is, the main things are, you know what this says. You know, you're not going to have to keep looking at it. You know what it says. You are other than it. And you have some sense of the piece you'd like to do, and you have some sense of the big deliverables, the public meeting, the report to council.
It seems like, just from listening to the conversation, there's probably some utility in sort of delaying making our judgments about what the critical issues are until we do the first phase of the research, because I think all of us think we understand the criminal justice system, but probably none of us really do, and we're all going to learn some stuff we didn't know, and things might emerge as, wow, that's really important, I never thought much about that before. So, I mean, I'm just suggesting that we not foreclose the possibility that that's going to happen.
And I've spent some time in the library. I tried to write a paper on, like, so what are the best practices in police reform? Basically, what I found was a bunch of books discussing the history of attempts at police reform, all of which failed. Like, police reform is extremely difficult because most of what you're trying to, a lot of what you're trying to change is officer discretion. But you can't affect officer discretion necessarily through a top-down policy. There's some things that we can change through policy. There's speed traps in town. We could change speed limits, and then the speed traps would be gone, right? That's, like, pretty straightforward. But, like, there's some things that are officer discretion that you actually can't legislate. So to affect officer discretion, I feel like what we would need would be, an extremely granular understanding of what's going on in town. And
but I think you're jumping ahead, John. I think we have to wait to say, is that really something? I mean, you're already evaluating, can we do this? So I think we want to wait and have that conversation.
No, I think that it is doable. Yeah. Absolutely.
Well, then there's the COPS program, the report out of Obama's administration about reform for community policing. I mean, there's a lot of stuff out there. There's a ton of stuff.
Okay.
It's 9:30.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot. Actually,
we need to do the groups.
Alternates.
Yes.
So why don't you count?
We're
going to
do three.
Count up
to three.
Cool.
Yeah.
Jim.
One. Two.
Three.
One. Two.
Okay. One.
Three.
Three.
One.
Two. Okay,
so
So we can use our emails to set up time that you were allowed to do or not.
Okay.
And when is our next group meeting? So the goal is to do this before the next meeting.
And what is the next meeting?
The next meeting, every meeting is going to be generally the second Tuesday of the month. However, November, second Tuesday of the month is November 8th. Do you remember what November 8th is?
No.
So that's election day.
Tuesday.
So we might want to do a different day that month, and I don't know if we want to think about that now, but maybe think about it next month.
Yeah, because I don't really want to do it for it, or I did for primaries, maybe I already asked you if I can do it.
Why don't we decide that, we can decide that next meeting.
So it's the second Tuesday.
Yeah, you get paid, they call it volunteering, but you still.
The next one is Tuesday, October 11th.
So, October 11th.
Can I ask a quick question, the threes are you, Asim, and myself?
I would suspect that Nia would then fit on that, because she was going to be sitting right there.
Your threes?
Yeah.
So we just have three of us.
So Fred, if you're, yes.
And we've got Al, John, Jennifer, and Allison, we're the ones, is this correct?
Yep.
Should we just plan to do it right now?
You should do it right now. Before you do, let's just think about agenda for next time, so we're going to be discussing this, is there, I'm going to leave it to Pat to just to send out, if there's anything else that needs to be on the agenda.
Send out an agenda?
You'll send out an agenda, and we will, is that okay with everybody? All righty. Well, I think that was good.
Yeah, thank you for bringing this together.
You and me and Pat, and Steve.
Steve?
Yep.
We'll just send out, should have an email.
And we're generally thinking 2 hours max, and if we're there, does that sound good?
What did you say on next meeting?
11.
11.
Next meeting.
That's Tuesday.
November 11th?
October.
October, November is the next one.
Yeah, and the next meeting will figure out the November date, we'll have to.
Is it going to be at 7:30?
Seven.
No.
It's 7:30, it's the time. So that's.
That's me and everyone else.
Okay, it's John Field 4.
Which is which?
October 11th. Do we want to change it?
What is it?
Yeah, John Field 4.
Change it on the board, all right.
Which, the night of it, or the day of it, or I should know?
Night.
Y'all don't need to change it, but I just won't be here.
Is that okay with everyone?
It probably looks kind of crappy to have that thing.
Yeah.
I think.
What did you say, it looks crappy?
Should we change it?
We should change it. Okay, what's the Wednesday? The one, what's the Wednesday of that week?
The 12th.
The 12th?
How's the 12th?
That says it's Yom Kippur.
I can.
Oh, you can't do Monday, yeah. What about Thursday?
It doesn't go up there. What about the 4th? What about doing it on a Tuesday?
So it is every second.
Jennifer, send out on Wednesday, it's over, right?
Oh, that's Rosh Hashanah.
Yeah, that's, there's holy days on the 4th.
Tuesday to 4th?
Big month for Jews.
Does that say Yom Kippur on Wednesday?
All right.
It says so on mine.
Oh, well, yours is special, oh, it says Monday.
It's like, it starts on Tuesday night.
And like over days, and in South Wales.
It's over Wednesday afternoon?
Sunday, I don't know.
What, Tuesday through Sunday? Or are you talking?
Okay, so you're talking about.
Are you talking about Rosh Hashanah?
When is Rosh Hashanah?
Could we do the 18th or the 17th of October?
Not the 18th.
I can't do the 17th.
19th?
I can't do Monday, so it's been time.
What about the 18th, does there, somebody can do it?
I think we have to acquire a moral condition.
Well, then why don't we just keep it the way it is?
Yeah, why not?
You know.
It's okay, Jerry, I'm going to come, I'll be here.
So wait, okay. So we are sitting to the.
I'm going to call them sick, I'll be calling them sick for the synagogue, so don't tell.
I am going to send out tentative minutes, and everybody can send me any, I mean, they're going to be basic.
I took notes.
And you can, that's okay. And so we'll send it out if you need to. They can they make changes over?
Just send directly to.
To me?
Just don't reply all.
Don't reply. Just send it to me. If you see anything, if I quoted you wrong and you're horrified by what I said, you said, let me know and I'll fix it.
So whenever Tuesday.
Thanks very much for putting.
So.
Yeah, yeah.
So what's the.
Okay, you want to figure out the time?
Pardon?